Christ, please. Please be seated, everyone. Thank you for being with us today. We're glad you're here. The prayer service will be a blessing to you. We give a special welcome. We understand that any number of Pastor Greg's members and friends are watching at their church in Sioux Falls. I'm sure it means a lot to him and his family that you're willing to do that for them. So God bless you for doing that. Before we begin, perhaps we could ask that you would turn your cell phone off or perhaps put it on vibrate so that it doesn't inadvertently go off and disturb our worship. The service we're following is printed for you in the worship folder. It's also projected to the front. The hymns are also projected to the front. If you'd like both words and music, you can follow with the hymn book that's in the rack in front. We'll begin in the name of the Father and the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We have come together to seek God's comfort in our sorrow and to rejoice in the promise of the resurrection. Grace and peace be to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, who said, "Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest." Let us pray. Lord Jesus, you wept at the grave of your friend Lazarus, and you consoled Mary and Martha in their distress. Draw near to us your mourning for Betty, and dry the tears of all who weep. Calm our troubled hearts, dispel our doubts and fears, and lead us to praise you for having brought her to faith. In your rising from the dead, you conquer death and open the gates to eternal life. Strengthen us with your word, and lead us through this earthly life until at last we are united with you and all the saints in glory everlasting. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. We'll continue with hymn 605.
Thank you.
Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who comforts us in all our troubles, so that we can comfort those in any trouble with the comfort we ourselves have received from God. The Apostle Paul writes to the Romans, "The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord." Jesus gives us this comfort. I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live even though he dies, and whoever lives and believes in me will never die. You're invited to join in the responsive reading. Death has been swallowed up in victory. Thanks be to God.
He gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ.
When Christ, who is our life, appears,
then we also will appear with him in glory.
We will be before the throne of God. Never again will we hunger.
Never again will we thirst.
For the Lamb at the center of the throne will be our shepherd. He will lead us to springs of living water.
God will wipe away every tear from our eyes.
Let us pray. God of all grace, you sent your Son Jesus to destroy the power of death and to open the kingdom of heaven to all believers. Make us certain that because he lives, we too shall live. Comfort us with your promise that neither death nor life, nor things present nor things to come, shall be able to separate us from your love, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord.
Amen.
Our first scripture lesson today is written in the 8th chapter of Paul's letter to the Romans. We'll read selected verses. We start with one of the most beautiful promises in the entire Bible, and we go on then with one of the most comforting words that the Bible gives us as well. We know that all things work together for the good of those who love God, for those who are called according to his purpose. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor rulers, nor things present nor things to come, nor powerful forces, neither height nor depth nor anything else in creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. This is the word. Our second lesson is written in the 4th chapter of Paul's second letter to Timothy. Paul knows that soon he is going to be leaving this world to go to heaven, and he says, "I have fought the good fight, I have finished the race, I have kept the faith. From now on there is reserved for me the crown of righteousness. The Lord, the righteous judge, will give it to me on that day, and not only to me, but also to everyone who loved his appearing." This is the word. And our gospel lesson today is written in the 14th chapter of St. John. We start with verse 1. Jesus himself is speaking and says, "Do not let your heart be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I am going to prepare a place for you. If I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and take you to be with me, so that you may also be where I am. You know where I am going, and you know the way." "Lord, we don't know where you are going," Thomas replied. "So how can we know the way?" Jesus said to him, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." This is the gospel of the Lord. Continue the next day.
Thank you.
have loved you with an everlasting love. Never will I leave you. Never will I forsake you. Amen. The words of God we'll consider today as we seek his comfort are written in the 23rd Psalm. We'll read the first and the last verses. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Surely, goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. This is God's word. In the name of our kind, caring, loving Lord, dear friends, family members, relatives of Betty, especially you, Pastor Greg, Renee, Henry, and you, of course, Alan. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. Along with John 3:16, those are probably some of the best loved and best known words in the entire Bible. And we can understand why. You think of John 3:16, which summarizes so simply and so clearly how it is that we escape hell and have everlasting life. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. God loves the world. God loves each one of you. He sent his Son for the world. He sent his Son for each one of you. Jesus has won forgiveness for all. He's won forgiveness for you. He's won eternal life for all. He's won eternal life for you. Believe in him, put your trust in him, and those blessings are yours personally to enjoy. And you can have that confidence that when you leave this world, you can know for sure you are going to be with him in heaven. And while you're here, we also have the beautiful assurance that the Lord is our shepherd. He's guiding us, he's watching over us, he's protecting us, he's helping us, he's seeing us through all things, making sure all things work for our good. What beautiful comfort. You can see why so many people love Psalm 23. And we're told that Betty did. She loved that fact that the Lord was her good shepherd, knowing that he was guiding her, watching over her, blessing her, and taking care of her in this life. And as we think of her life and the blessings the Lord gave to her, how he watched over her and how he used her to be a blessing, I think we can see that the Lord truly was her good shepherd. When you think of Betty, what comes to mind? Her personality. She had a positive, upbeat personality. I don't think in the years that I knew her, I don't think I ever saw her in a bad mood. She cared about people. She was concerned about people, and that showed. I know in dealing with her, it seemed that there were times where she kind of sensed when somebody was maybe down or a little depressed, and she would do what she could to build them up and to encourage them. She loved her family. If you knew her, you knew that. She loved them. They were extremely important to her. And she loved doing things for them. She loved spending time with them. And as you know, for over 40 years or so, she was a nurse. And the personality she had, truly caring about people, helped to make her a very good nurse. And I was told that she always went above and beyond what was required, always doing her best for her patients, doing what she could to give them the best care that she could. And you think of those things, those blessings, the person she was, the nurse that she was, a devoted wife, a loving mother, a caring grandmother, How is it that she was all those things? It all goes back to the Lord. As Paul says, it's the grace, by the grace of God, I am what I am. And that's true for each one of us, and that was true for her too. It was the Lord who molded and shaped her into the person that she was. And sometimes, often, more often than we like, the Lord uses times of testing, difficult times, even painful times, to draw us closer to Him, to force us to grow again, to mold and to shape us. And that was true for Betty too. Early in her teen years, her father was killed unexpectedly in an accident. And that's tough, that goes without saying, that's tough. We need our parents the most when we're doing our growing up, And when you lose a parent and you're still doing your growing up, that's hard, that's difficult. And Betty went through that. But the Lord was with her, the Lord helped her. The Lord, again, worked through that and other things to mold her, to shape her, to be the person that she was. And we think of blessings that God gave to her. We know the greatest blessing of all. The fact that she knew and believed these words. For God so loved the world that He gave His one and only Son, that whoever believes in Him shall not perish but have eternal life. Betty knew that, believed that. She knew that she was a sinful person. She confessed her sins many, many times throughout her life. And she knew what sinners deserved, what she deserved. We all deserve to die. We deserve to perish forever in hell. But she knew God loved the world. That means God loved her. She knew Jesus died for all people. She knew Jesus died for her. She knew Jesus forgave all sins. She knew her sins were forgiven. She knew Jesus had won eternal life for the world. That means Jesus had won eternal life for her. She knew that by the grace of God, she believed that. So she enjoyed those blessings as her own. And she knew beyond a shadow of a doubt that when that time came, she would go to be with the Lord in heaven. And until that time, she knew that as God's dear child through faith in Jesus, that she was Jesus' lamb, that He was her good shepherd, and that He was going to guide her throughout life. Think of those words. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. The word there for follow has the idea of to pursue or to chase after. Maybe you can think of a dog. If you're out on the farm and the dog sees a rabbit, boom, a beeline for that rabbit, chasing him, not giving up. Or sometimes, you think on the farm where the dog would get attached to the children or one of the kids, and they're outside, no matter where the child goes, the dog is right there with that child. That's a picture of God's grace. No matter where we are, God's goodness and mercy are right there. No matter what we go through, no matter what we have to face, God's goodness and mercy are always right there to help us. And God's goodness and mercy were always right there with Betty. And as she got older, she faced some unique challenges. In 2009, she suffered a severe heart attack. And there was real concern about what was going to happen. She was in Sioux Falls. They couldn't help her. She ended up at the University of Minnesota, and there were questions about, is there going to be surgery? Will a heart transplant be needed? Or questions, will she even make it through this? Well, the Lord gave a yes answer to the many prayers that were offered. She didn't need surgery. She recovered sufficiently that she could return to her home and have a pretty much normal life. And 13 and a half years or so, the Lord gave to her. And we say, thank you, Lord, for your goodness and mercy in her life. Thank you, Lord, for letting us have her for those extra 13 and a half years. She needed God's goodness and mercy as she got a little older. Her mind started to fail. She wasn't remembering things. Talking with Alan, she would ask a question, and then a couple of minutes later ask the same question again. Forgetting where she put things, it was getting harder and harder for her. But God's goodness and mercy were always there, and providing a man who truly loved her and was always there to watch her and take care of her. God bless you, Alan, for caring for her. And then, earlier this month, the fall, the stroke, and she starts to go downhill, and it becomes apparent that the Lord is going to take her home. And even then, God's goodness and mercy were there. And Alan commented about the care that she received and the hospice facility that they were in, the people who helped and took care of her. They were just absolutely wonderful. He said, thank you, Lord, for giving her that care and for keeping her comfortable. And then, last week, the Lord put an end to all her earthly struggles. And there's no more struggles with memory, no more pills to try to keep straight to make sure she would stay in good health. All over with. Now, in glory with the Lord, we think again. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. She is now with the Lord forever in glory. And when you think of Betty's life, the many blessings God gave to her, guiding her, seeing her through difficult times, molding and shaping her to be the special person that she was, and working through her to be such a blessing to so many others. You think of where she is now and what she has now, we realize, yes, the Lord truly was her good shepherd. And he is your good shepherd, too. You think again of those words, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. What we need, the Lord makes sure we have. When we're grieving, when we're hurting, the Lord makes sure we have the help that we need. You think again. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. And it's a comfort. That's one of the greatest things of our Christian faith, is the certainty that God gives to us. That through Jesus there is no doubt about our relationship with God. There's no doubt where Betty is right now. And there's wonderful comfort knowing for sure where she is and what she has right now. But at the same time, we still hurt. And there's tears. And in the days ahead, there might be some painful days where it's difficult. And there will be times when she jumps into your mind, you might think, boy, I wish I could pick up the phone. And then you can't. It's difficult. And I think as we get older, we have to do this more and more. And depending on how close you are to a person, it can be really, really difficult. And that's been a comfort. It's a comfort to know the Lord is our shepherd. And that goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. That God's goodness and mercy will be there to give you strength, to give you comfort, to help you to heal, and to help you to go on. And we think again that we dwell in the house of the Lord forever. We know where she is, and one day we will be there too, with her, with all believers, never to be separated again. Like Betty, we know those words, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. Comforting words, important words, eh? Because funerals make it very real. They remind us again, people die. I'm going to die one day, it's just a matter. matter of when and how you are going to die one day. It's just a matter of when and how. And for some, that's an uncomfortable thought. Some people don't like thinking about that. Some people don't like going to funerals because of that. Some people are scared stiff at the thought of dying, and their consciences kick in, and they think of mistakes that they've made, and it comes to mind of what's going to happen to me when I die? What is God going to do to me when I die? Is God going to want somebody like me? Is he going to take somebody like me to heaven after the things I've done in my life? And then we remember, God loved the world. That means God loves you. He sent his son Jesus for the whole world. He sent his son Jesus for you. Jesus died for all people and has forgiven all sins. That includes you. And he's won eternal life for all people, and that includes you. By the grace of God, we know this, and we believe in this, and that means we have, again, that certainty, that confidence. Yes, your sins are forgiven. God is not going to turn against you. Yes, you are his dear child. And when you leave this world, you can have that confidence, that absolute certainty that you too will be with the Lord in glory forever. We can thank the Lord for that and say, thank you, Lord, for being our good shepherd. Thank you for being Betty's good shepherd. That your mercy, your goodness and mercy were with her all the days of her life, and that now, again, she is dwelling in the house of the Lord forever. And as we go through this life, God will be with us, God will comfort us, God will strengthen us, God will help us. His goodness and mercy will be there always. And when that time comes, we will be with Betty and all those God has saved, and we will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Betty Jean Strobel was born October 4th, 1942, to Albert and Matilda Strobel in Ashley, North Dakota. She lived there and graduated from Ashley High School in 1960. The summer after her graduation, she moved to Aberdeen and began to work at St. Luke's Hospital. It was this experience that set her along the path for caring for others through her career in nursing. She left her summer job at St. Luke's in the fall and enrolled at the School of Practical Nursing in Mitchell. In 1962, she received her license as an LPN. She returned to Aberdeen to begin her nursing career with St. Luke's. Over many years, Betty worked at the Bethesda Nursing Home, always graciously taking on additional shifts for her fellow nurses and caregivers. Betty worked many years for the Aberdeen Orthopedic Surgery Specialist. She retired from nursing in 2003. She was united in marriage to Alan Blair on May 31st, 1964. The Lord blessed them with a son, Greg. Greg was married to his wife, Renee, on June 30th, 1990, and from this union was born Betty and Alan's one and only granddaughter, Reagan. After retirement, Betty and Alan enjoyed traveling by bus tours. Betty loved her family, loved entertaining and serving her family and church. She was energetic, a fun and loving grandma. Whether it was with grandma's sleepovers, to variety shows, to game nights with Reagan, grandma and the great aunties, time with grandma was always fun. She enjoyed cooking and loved baking. She loved to please others with her home-baked love. Betty was so passionate about caring for others first. She lived her life with love and service for others. She was gracious, so very kind and generous. We will miss her infectious smile. We will miss her greatly. Betty is survived by her loving husband, Alan, her son, Greg, his wife, Renee, daughter, Regan, a sister, Alice, a sister-in-law, Eileen, and many other nieces and nephews. She was preceded in death by her parents, her sister, Violet, her sister, Esther, and her brother, Herbert. The Lord took her home to heaven January 19, 2023, at the age of 80 years, 3 months, and 15 days. To God alone be glory. We'll continue by confessing our Christian faith according to the words of the Apostles' Creed. The Apostles' Creed, we read, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We'll continue with the hymn 56.
Thank you.
Almighty God, we praise you for the great company of saints who have finished their lives in faith and now rest from their labors. We remember especially our loved one, Betty, whom you have redeemed by the blood of your Son and received as your child through holy baptism. We thank you for giving her to us as a companion on our earthly pilgrimage. In your compassion, comfort all who are sad in this hour. Lord, in your mercy, we praise you for your love in Christ, which sustains us in life and death. In our earthly sorrows, help us find strength in your promises, joy in the forgiveness of sins, and hope in the resurrection to eternal life. Lord, in your mercy, you do not leave us comfortless, but strengthen and care for us through your word and sacrament. You give us family, friends, and neighbors to help when there is loneliness now and in the days to come. Brighten our future with a firm trust in your promises and care. Lord, in your mercy, remove our fears and make us bold to pray with confidence as our Savior has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. After service, we'll continue to the cemetery for the committal, and after that, we'll return here where lunch will be served. We ask you now to rise.